All right, is the mic on? We're good? So thank you, Chris. Thank you, organizers. Thank you, LCA. This is my first time at a LinuxConf AU, and so far it's been an absolutely phenomenal experience. The privilege to be here on this stage this morning is something I cannot express. So thank you all. I hope I do your time justice. As Chris said, my name is Dan. I have to start by apologizing that I use Linux, but I'm using a Mac right now because the option of using Keynote to actually create a keynote was too great to resist. I also want to have a disclaimer that what I'm about to share are my personal reflections. Though I was on the team from the very early days until its last moments, what I'm saying doesn't necessarily represent an official position of Mozilla or the official position of the former team. I work for Mozilla, and Mozilla works for the web. When I say that, what I mean is that Mozilla is a nonprofit organization dedicated to the safeguarding and the advancement of the internet as a public resource. We work to make sure that the web stays open, interoperable, and standards-based. And we do that in many ways, through policy advocacy, through education, through research, and what we're best known for, through our engineering efforts on the Firefox web browser. Firefox is free and open source software, and we build it not for the sake of building a browser, not because it's a challenging project, but we build Firefox to help protect the internet as a public resource, so that when some of the world's largest corporations meet to determine the future of their browsers, and thus the future of the web as a platform, that we're in that room and that we've earned our place at the table as a peer and as a fellow implementer of the web, but without a profit motive. I'm fortunate to be joined at this conference with several other Mozillians. If you're curious about what we're doing about advancing the state of the web, there are talks on Servo and Rust later today and then on Thursday. I'd encourage you to attend those. But when Mozilla looks at the web, we feel like the potential that is there is too precious, it's too transformative. It has the ability to connect, to transcend borders, to empower. It's too great of a potential to leave blindly in the hands of these large corporations. That mission resonated with me. Mozilla's stance as an open organization resonated with me. And I had the good fortune 5 years ago to be given an opportunity to join Mozilla full time to work on Persona. Persona was designed to solve authentication on the web. And it looked a little bit like this. You would go to a website and click on a sign-in button, and your browser would display a pop-up that prompted you to enter your email address. And you could put any address you wanted in this field. Persona would look at the domain, in this case Gmail, and then forward you to an authentication page on that domain. So I see a normal Google login screen. I hit allow. My address has been verified. I'm signed in. Because we built all this on public key crypto, my browser now had a short-lived certificate attesting to my identity, which I could then use to log into other websites with just two clicks. The really interesting thing about Persona was that we had designed the system in a way that was fully decentralized, or it started centralized, but every aspect of it, as it gained traction, as it was implemented, these centralized scaffolds would fall away and you'd be left with this freestanding, decentralized authentication system. So the email domain was what we'd look at. We'd try to discover, do you speak the Persona protocol? If so, we'll do a custom redirect over to that domain. You can log in however your email provider wants you to authenticate. If your provider didn't support Persona, we would actually stand in and vouch for you by completing a traditional email verification workflow. So we'd send you a link, you click on it, set up a password, and you've proven that you have access to that address, and thus Mozilla would vouch for your identity. But the moment that your domain supported the protocol, that centralized scaffolding goes away and we authenticate directly with your domain. The browser pop-up you saw also was something that had an open protocol and the browsers could implement natively, which would allow the UI to be replaced instead of with a web page hosted at persona.org with something that's living within your browser itself. I want to start by convincing you that authentication matters, that trying to solve this problem was a worthy and a necessary investment of Mozilla's time in safeguarding the web. And to do that, I want to start by revisiting where the web was 5 years ago. Site-specific passwords were being kind of forced out by these large breaches of organizations like LinkedIn. In 2012, we learned that LinkedIn had lost something like 6.5 million passwords. They were SHA-1 encrypted or SHA-1 hashed, but they were not salted, easy to reverse. We learned last year that by 6.5 million, they actually meant 167 million, but that's, you know, that's a small difference. But so you start looking at a context where large sites are being compromised left and right, day after day after day. And you know that if a large site like LinkedIn isn't handling passwords correctly, one, there's very little you can do as a user to ensure your safety. But also, users rarely actually follow good password hygiene. I mean, how many people can honestly say that they do not have a reused password anywhere on their online presence? LCA, yeah, sure. So for those watching the stream, it was one person, only one. But the challenge of getting 7 billion humans to change their practices and to adopt password managers and securely generate things is a very, very difficult problem. And I don't think it's a solvable one. So 5 years ago, we were starting to see alternatives emerge, predominantly social authentication, the notion that if you have an account with Facebook, well, why don't you just authenticate there and then chain into another website? Some large companies, Spotify, Pinterest, went so far as to only offer social authentication. And so at Mozilla, we were seeing this trend away from email and password. We were killing the password field, which is good, but the email field was also going away. And that meant this notion of being able to host your own identity, being able to choose how you identify, was also going away. And that felt like the soul of the internet was being diminished. But what was much more common, and this is a very old screenshot, 500 pixels says, fix the thing I'm about to point out. A more common pattern was to split the user experience, where you could choose a traditional email and password workflow on one side, or a series of social buttons on the other side. And this seems like the best of both worlds, because the user can choose the mechanism that makes sense for them. And I took this screenshot because this was the first time, you get used to seeing Facebook and Google and Twitter. I hadn't seen a clout button before. And clout, if you don't recall, it's still around. It's a company that would quantify your social network value, your influence, so that companies would know who to appease or pay off to shill for their products. I thought this was curious. 500 pixels is an online photo gallery. Why is clout? So I clicked the clout button. It's like Facebook, Twitter, clout. And of course, clout asked me to log in with Facebook or Twitter. So we were rushing headlong away from passwords without noticing that we were making some really bizarre decisions. And on the persona team, we were delighted to find this recursive authentication. We thought we could find a cycle somewhere, because for a while, Yahoo actually allowed you to log into Yahoo with Google or Facebook. And we were hoping there was a quid pro quo somewhere, and a Yahoo button would appear on one of those other properties. You can just go around and around and around. It didn't happen. But nevertheless, we were building these things, and I don't think it was deliberate. We needed to get away from passwords. We knew they were bad. Maybe this new thing that also lets people log into our sites is good. What's rarely considered, though, is that this imposes a third party between you and your user. And it subjects your users to that third party's terms of service. And systems like Facebook have policies that require that you use what they call your authentic name, which is their whitewashing of the term real name. Facebook doesn't allow you to use a name that you can't verify with government ID or with medical records or utility bills. And if you have a name that they suspect isn't authentic, by which we usually mean isn't sufficiently Western European, your account can be suspended until you provide that documentation to Facebook and await a judgment. So in a world without anonymity, there are no anonymous whistleblowers. In a world without pseudonymity, there's no J.K. Rowling or Robert Galbraith. There's no ability for us to control how we identify in different contexts. And that's a fundamental human right that the web, as this democratizing, empowering medium, needs to preserve. There's no ability for someone who's transitioning to go by the name that they would prefer without risking being inadvertently outed or disconnected from the sites that they would otherwise depend on. So this is Kim Tallbear. Her legal name is Tall Bear, capitalized as it is. She was suspended from Facebook in 2015. She faxed in her government documentation that reported her name exactly as you see it there. And Facebook said, okay, we agree that your last name is Tall Bear, but we'll need to see some further evidence about your unusual capitalization in your last name. And this is an affliction that I'm sure Kim McDonald faces on a daily basis. We can't build the future of the web. We can't build a free society atop a platform that prevents the agency of self-identification. And Persona fixes this. By working on Persona, you could use any email address you wanted. You could use any identity you wanted. And we felt on the team that we were truly fighting for the future of the web. We were truly trying to preserve this core value that makes the web powerful. So if you go to websites today, now 5 years since Persona was really underway, you see a login screen like this. This is Raygun. They adopted Persona. They're based out of Wellington. Today, they now offer a traditional auth up top, social buttons on the bottom. And that means Persona failed. We didn't do it. We didn't make it. We showed it was possible. We didn't succeed in changing the web. Now, fortunately, the pendulum has come swinging back. Sites like Spotify, even Clout, now offer a traditional email and password login. It's not great, but it's better than nothing. In addition to being a software engineer, I'm also a trained cave diver. This is not a photo of me, but it is a photo of a place I have been. This is the Devil's Lip in Ginny Springs. Being a cave diver means I enjoy finding flooded holes in the ground and swimming as far into them as possible. People politely don't overtly question my sanity, but they do ask things like, what could you possibly see down there, Dan? And as you can see in this picture, it's largely this. On most dives, almost all your dives, you see something like this, which is dimly lit wet rocks and a lot of water. But if your fortune is just so, instead of this, you see something more like this, which is to say nothing because your lights failed, or a slightly browner shade of nothing. I don't know if you can tell on the projector, nothing, browner, nothing. And this isn't because you've realized what the predicament you've placed yourself in voluntarily is and soiled yourself. It's more because you've misplaced a kick and disturbed some silt, and now you've blown the visibility, and your dive is more of a tactile experience than a visual one. And so this is dangerous. At the entrance to most caves, and to be technical, there's a notion of open water where if something goes wrong, you can say, like, I'm out of here, and just go straight up, and you'll probably be okay. There's the cavern zone where you have, you know, about 40 meters between yourself and open water, you can see daylight. And then there's the cave zone where you can't see daylight, you can't see open water. At that transition, most local diving communities will place a sign that has the Grim Reaper beckoning you into the cave, standing over the corpses of three scuba divers, and says, stop, prevent your death, go no farther. Fact, more than 300 divers, including open water scuba instructors, have died in caves just like this one. Fact, you needed training to dive, you need cave training and cave equipment to cave dive. Fact, it can happen to you. There is nothing in this cave worth dying for. Do not go beyond this point. And so if you're me, you see one of these and you say, I want to go beyond that point. But then you go back to bullet number two and you say, oh, there's equipment and training. I can learn how to go beyond this point. The property that distinguishes technical diving from recreational diving is that in a technical environment, be it you have some sort of barrier. So it could be a decompression obligation, you could be inside a wreck, you could be inside a cave. There's something that prevents you from surfacing. If something goes wrong, if a system that you depend on, if some of the infrastructure that's keeping you going in this environment fails, you have to solve it, or you don't make it out. I think there's some things that the software world can learn from the way that the cave training, the way the education works. There are practical parts. You learn skills, like how to better fine-tune your trim, your buoyancy. You learn kicks. You learn how to set and follow guidelines. Every single practical dive you go on tests a system failure. your fin strap breaks, your mask fails, your lights fail, your tanks fail. Every single dive in your training, you try something failing, and you learn how to deal with it, and you learn how to make your way out, and you learn how to withstand these systems going away unexpectedly. There's also a classroom component, and that component is almost exclusively dominated by looking at past accidents, which is a euphemism for dives where the diver didn't come back, and analyzing what happened, what went wrong, what was the problem that arose that was not solvable in the moment, and how can we avoid repeating that mistake. This method of learning and of educating really began in the late 1970s when Chuck Exley published Basic Cave Diving, A Blueprint for Survival. In this book, Chuck looked at all of the known cave diving deaths up until that point and tried to determine, you know, what sort of rules could we follow to avoid those? Are there generalizable causes of failure? He called them his five rules of accident analysis. Never exceed your training. Don't cave dive if you're not cave trained. Have a guideline to open water. Reserve 2/3 of your gas for the exit, which means that at any point you can take twice as long to get out, or you can take another person all the way out. Never exceed the maximum operational depth of your gas. Because of the way caves work, you sometimes breathe different ratios of oxygen, nitrogen, and helium. Those gases have envelopes in which they are great and envelopes in which they are toxic. And then the fifth rule, carry three lights. In Chuck's estimation, these five rules would have prevented all known cave deaths up until 1979. I don't have the body of experience, the wealth of research to propose anything nearly so absolute for free software, but I do have a single accident that we can analyze. 3 weeks ago, we switched the Persona servers to read-only. In time, they'll fall off the internet, and it'll be done. There will be no more Persona. There will be an opportunity for something to come after it. And we don't have a culture of owning up to and admitting and critically examining these failures. So I'd like to start. I'd also like to encourage you, if you have a project that's recently or previously failed, or if you have a project that is failing, share what's going on. Share what you're learning so that we can avoid making those same mistakes. The first thing we learned with Persona is that just having a free license is not enough. It's not enough to mitigate the cost of failure. It's not enough to ensure that your project can survive. I'm going to talk about what I mean by that, walk through some of the things that I think we could have done differently in Persona to give it a greater chance of survival, and then talk about what we can do as project authors to plan for when even that isn't enough, when our project will die. So I say free licenses aren't enough. What I mean is that a free and open source license does not mean that your users, the people dependent on you, are meaningfully empowered to continue your project, to avoid harm from your project dying. So specifically with Persona, we had inadvertently built in an intractable point of centralization into the protocol. In order to protect your privacy, we didn't let the email provider and the website speak directly to each other. They had to go through a relay. So that your email provider knows that you're going to sign in somewhere because it had to issue the certificate, but it doesn't know where you then provided that certificate. We had designed the protocol so that eventually a browser could natively implement this, and the browser itself could act as the relay. But in the absence of that, as a bootstrapping mechanism, we were going to use login.persona.org/communication-iframe as this relay. And so the notion was the site you're trying to log into, and the site that you're authenticating with would both open an iframe to the same origin, and they'd post a message in, like, I need a certificate. Okay, here's your certificate, and post it out. And they'd be blinded from who exactly the other was. I think if we hadn't been within Mozilla, we wouldn't have been so audacious to have predicated the design and predicated the decentralization of the system on a browser natively implementing our protocol. Because what we didn't plan for was an eventuality where Mozilla stopped supporting the project before we had native browser support. And because of the way this works, because these two parties on the sides can't communicate, they can't negotiate and decide on a common relay. And they have to trust that relay because you're passing key material through it. Which means if someone tried to fork the project, you would have to also fork the entire community. So even though the websites and the email providers are speaking the same protocol, you couldn't meaningfully take advantage of it. Because the website has a preconceived notion of what relay it should use, and it would send the cert request in there. But the email provider is listening on a completely different domain. They'd never see it. I honestly think this is something that could have been solved in a different way if we weren't a browser vendor. We were blinded by our context. We also learned that bits rot much more quickly online. We're at LCA. I was thinking, I don't care if the Document Foundation goes away. I mean, I do care. But if LibreOffice was unmaintained, I would still have those bits. I could still run them on my computer. I could still read and edit my documents. And it's still safe for me to do so, provided I'm not opening untrusted documents. I'm not providing untrusted input. Compare that to what would happen if you stopped updating and stopped patching WordPress. Not because WordPress is bad, it's because security is hard. And if you're not patching a system, if you're not paying hosting bills, then in a few months, that system's not going to be there. It's either not going to be yours, or it's not going to be online any longer. And the answer to this isn't to abandon the web, because the web has this virtue of this universality, of this openness, of this democratization. But we have to do better about allowing software to be written to run stable, to run securely, without intervention, without specialized skills. I don't know how to do that, and that's why it's a keynote and not a practical session. But it's something we need to solve. The Sandstorm project is doing some really interesting work about how to allow individuals to run web apps in a way that's secure. But what happens when Sandstorm stops being maintained? We also learned that complexity limits agency. If you're building a software system that depends on, or a service that depends on, a number of databases, cron jobs, other processes, there's a degree of finesse and sophistication required just to start the project, just to run the project, much less run it securely. And that knowledge and that time and that effort is something that if you know how to even start the project, you can get a wage in a first world country that puts you in the upper middle class just for knowing how to run the thing. That doesn't meaningfully empower other humans. That doesn't meaningfully empower people that aren't pouring their lives and their livelihoods into this field. Put another way, a free license doesn't further my freedom if I can't meaningfully run the software. Free licenses don't solve bit rot. They don't solve intractable centralization. They don't solve operational complexity. Again, keynote, I don't know how you fix that, but maybe you do. Second thing I want to talk about are things that you can do to prolong your project's life. And a quick acknowledgement, if you ever need pictures of things burning, the US government. So if you go on Flickr, you can say US government works, and they're free of copyright. And apparently, the military lights a lot of things on fire to train people in how to put the fires out. So again, it's that what if something goes wrong? Let's plan for it. Very important. And you get, this fire's pretty. So there were a lot of things that we did with Persona that were mistakes, that were little mistakes, that created friction. Pop-ups. We used a pop-up for the UI because we wanted to be able to keep your state on the web page. We also learned that people reflexively close pop-ups. It doesn't matter if you directly click the button and the pop-up opens directly in response to your click. Immediately, swap, gone. And then they would sit and wonder, why isn't Persona working? I'm not blaming the user. That's our fault. We built a system that didn't mesh with the heuristics expected by our users. We also built an API. This was a JavaScript project. We built an API that behaved differently if one of the arguments was false, null, or undefined. Not if it was falsy, not if it was any of those. Each of those behaved differently. And so many bugs. But these are little things. They're specific. I don't think they're generalizable. The bigger things that we did that I think limited our longevity that we didn't measure the right thing. We didn't know who we were. And when I say we didn't know who we were, I mean the distinction between is persona a product or is persona infrastructure? And that has all of these rippling ramifications around, does persona have its own brand? Does it present that brand? Is it subservient to the site's brand? We staffed and we built persona as though it were a product, which means we also measured its success as though it were a product based on how many sites are using persona, how many more sites than last week, how many users are we putting through the system? If we had looked at persona as an infrastructure tool instead, we would have been asking questions like, is this solving a real problem in a way that's cost effective? And I think we have a much stronger claim to the latter than the former, because we didn't have the traction, we didn't have the growth, but we were successfully powering authentication, and even just within Mozilla, on dozens of services. But also we were staffed and we were running at a burn rate that was befitting of something that would have network effects and that would go viral and would kind of have this hockey stick of growth. I don't think that's something that we understood at the time or that we intrinsically knew at the time. And in retrospect, I think that drove a lot of our design decisions in a way that weren't necessarily appropriate for what our project actually was. There's a bit of hubris. We're going to solve the web. Which goes to the second point, that it's important to explicitly define and communicate. And the communication part is crucial. You have to make sure other people know what your scope is. What is your project? What is not your project? This is the difference for persona between persona verifies email addresses and persona solves authentication. And we ran towards that latter, which meant that we had our own notion of an account system. We had our own notion of stateful session management. So if a site rendered and it said, I'm rendering this page and nobody's logged in, and persona said, oh, but I should be logged in, persona would automatically try to fire a callback to say, log me in, because that's what my user wanted. And if that login failed and the site came back and said, okay, I'm rendering an error page and nobody's logged in, then persona would say, oh, but I should be logged in, and and around and around and around. And so we built persona in a way that almost made the sites have to be subservient to it. I don't think that was quite right. At the same time, within Mozilla, we were trying to stand up the Firefox OS project and an open web app marketplace. We were trying to bootstrap a brand new mobile phone from the web. And phones need authentication, and marketplaces need authentication, and persona does authentication. And so from a distance, it looked like this thing over here should be able to fit into that hole over there. And sure enough, with enough force, you can do it. Because we took a system that was decentralized, password optional, and verified email addresses, and made it possible through configuration options to run it as a service that was centralized, password required, and didn't necessarily verify an email address. And this wasn't because the needs of Firefox OS were wrong. It's because persona wasn't the right tool for the job, and we didn't fully appreciate that. Because authentication is authentication, right? It's because we didn't communicate our scope. We didn't create that common understanding of here is what we're good at, and here is why that's valuable, and here's why it's okay if you have to find another project or another way to solve this other problem. Because the needs of OS were legit. It just wasn't what we did best. Which leads to the need to ruthlessly oppose complexity. On every philosophical design direction, the decentralization, the password requirement, the verification of emails, we had also implemented something that was diametrically opposed to it. And that led to, because it was all runtime configurable, this combinatoric explosion of API interdependencies and state machine paths that were incredibly difficult to confidently test against. And so when I was talking about free licenses not being enough, I meant that in terms of complexity for operational costs. This is more about your actual code. If your code is needlessly complex, if your code is needfully complex, but it just is complex, that means it's going to be harder to review patches, it's going to be harder to establish context, it's going to be harder to come back to your project after a week or a weekend away and be able to work on it, and be able to move the project forward. Which means it's harder for other contributors to come in and to start maintaining your project and start contributing to your project. It means that when you die, when your project is done, when your involvement with your project is done, it's harder for someone else to pick up that baton and keep running with it. Ruthlessly fight against complexity. The question to ask is, how hard is it for you to say confidently that the system behaves the way you believe it behaves? If you can't do that immediately, if you can't grasp the system, they're quantifiable metrics. You can measure the complexity of your call graph. Simplify, simplify, simplify. Focus, focus, focus. Know what you are, know what success means. Define your scope, communicate your scope. Keep your code approachable and maintainable. The complexity within Persona meant that we only had one or two outside contributors who made meaningful contributions to the core of Persona, which meant that when Mozilla decided to step away, the ability to have people actively involved and actively working on the code was a lot harder for us. But even if we had done everything right, at some point, every project fails. On a long enough timeline, every project will fail. We joke about bus factors. Somebody gets hit by a bus and now they can't maintain the software, but sometimes it's a commuter bus and it comes and it picks that person up and it just takes them to another job. Organizational priorities change. You can't anticipate what black swan event will happen, but things can happen. And on a long enough timeline, things will happen. It's crucial to plan for the end of your project at the beginning of your project. The first thing I'm going to share is something that I feel personally responsible for and that I personally regret in the handling of Persona shutdown. And that's, if you know you're dead, say it. If you know your project is not going to make any further progress, let people know. It took us 3 years from the day that we moved all staff off of Persona to the day that we pulled the plug on the servers. It took us 6 months from that de-staffing moment before we said, okay, we're going to try to keep this running, we're going to maintain it, we're going to patch it, but we're not going to do further development. It took us another 20 months. We knew early on, but it took us 20 more months before we said, hey, this isn't working, we're gonna end of life this in a year. If you know your project is dead, say it. Let people know. How often do we see in the free software world the project blog and it says, you know, the last post was from 3 years ago and it says, I know I've been away for a year, but I'm coming back and I'm gonna make this project great and you just wait. Maybe that's more okay with native software, but with services, this is expensive. We paid thousands of dollars in bug bounties for people that found security vulnerabilities. We were running an extremely old version of Node.js for the longest time because, hey, it's working, it's very complex. We don't want to upgrade because that might break and we don't have the engineering hours to pour into that. Also, as long as it's still there, there's this fear that by admitting that it's dead, that we make that so. That as long as we don't say anything, there's a chance that it'll come back. And within Mozilla, it was clear at that moment, we were undergoing some very high-level strategic shifts around Firefox OS, around the web, trying to figure out what the future of Mozilla was. It was clear who had the prerogative to say, you are not working on Persona any longer. It was not clear who had the prerogative to say, Mozilla will not work on Persona any longer, that we're not going to revisit it. And so we left it in this state of limbo. And that sucked all of the oxygen out of the room. These other people, these other projects that were interested in building on what we did in the same way that we built on OpenID weren't able to get off the sidelines and start working because they were waiting for us to come back. And we didn't tell them that we weren't coming back. We lost 3 years of innovation because we didn't admit we were dead. As an aside, we're at a conference. I think we're seeing the same thing happening with a private project, Lanyard, which was the Wikipedia of conferences for the longest time. They got acquired, you have a project blog saying, oh, this is gonna be great. You have a couple of updates where they integrated with their acquirer systems, and then nothing, and now they're suffering uptime difficulties. And you see these conversations on Twitter about, well, don't they have an export option? Can't you get your data out? And they do, but that doesn't help if the software system isn't online. The sooner you admit that you're dead, the sooner that people can begin to prepare for your replacement, the sooner people can start archiving and saving your data. You don't have that 2 week rush when Yahoo said GeoCities is going away at the end of the month. An archive team had to stand up and say, all right, give us all your bandwidth. We're gonna try to pull as much of this history of the internet as we can. If you give people warning, they can prepare for your departure. It's also crucial that your users can recover from the death of your software without your direct involvement. Again, this could be because of bus factor, this could be because of lost interest. In the case of Persona, we genuinely felt like we were fighting for the internet. We thought that this was an existential threat, and we thought we could solve it. And when you're told that you're not going to solve it, you didn't win, it's heartbreaking. and you suffer things that feel a lot like burnout. And I think this is also true in the free software world, where more broadly, where so much of our work is a passion project. It's something that we believe in, something that we're pouring our heart and soul into. And so if it dies, there are psychological, there are human effects to that. And it means that even if you have the best intentions of writing all the good transition documentation, of helping your users migrate away, of helping people export, the chance of you actually mustering the energy to do that in a timely manner, it's really hard. It's really hard. The people that actually successfully brought Persona to its conclusion were folks that were on the periphery. Gene Wood, who did operations for Persona, Ryan Kelly, who's out of Melbourne, he was working in the identity group, but not as directly on Persona. They didn't get the same degree of like PTSD from the shutdown of Persona, and so they were able to say, okay, we'll line the things up, we'll take charge, we'll carry this across the line. What we learned, though, was that with Persona, our plan, we had consciously decided that every website you sign into would see your email address. It wouldn't be obscured. The sites would know who you were. They would have an ability to communicate with you. And because we used an email address, a piece of data that was useful independent of Persona, useful outside of Persona, that meant that our kind of transition plan in was, oh, you just drop your password column, use Persona, and you're done. But you could also do the opposite. You could add a password column. You could send everyone a reset link. And now you're off of Persona. And this worked. Most sites, the sites that did transition, a lot of services in Mozilla just decided to pull the plug, were able to write a normal traditional email authentication workflow. Or they were able to switch over to hosted services like Auth0 has an email auth product. And so by giving the users, giving the people that were depending on Persona data that they could use even without Persona being there, they were able to self-rescue. They were able to keep moving forward. You see this in Firefox Sync. So Firefox accounts and Firefox Sync have still some code that was directly derived from Persona. So the legacy of the engineering lives on in Mozilla. But with Firefox Sync, sure, you're syncing your bookmarks, your passwords, your open tabs to some service in the cloud. But if that service goes away, sure, you stop getting updates on both your devices, but your devices have a full archive of your data. You've made the user hold what they need to recover. They'd be inconvenienced, but they wouldn't be stuck. So I don't know how that applies to other projects. I know that using standard data formats seems to be key. The news reader I use, NewsBlur, well, actually, if you change a lot of your subscriptions, if you unsubscribe from a bunch of feeds, if you add a bunch of feeds, they'll email you and say, hey, I saw you changed a bunch of things. If you didn't mean to do this, here's a backup of your subscriptions as they last were. And it turns out that backup's an OPML file, which is a standard way of representing RSS feeds. Which means that if NewsBlur went away tomorrow, sure, I'd be one revision out of date, but I have implicitly in my email, in this archive, what my subscriptions looked like, and I could recover from that. And so forcing your users to own and hold their data seems to be key as we move to these services that if they become unmaintained, go away very quickly. I think the core thing to ask yourself as a maintainer when you go back to your projects is how can you minimize the harm that's caused when your project goes away? If you pull the plug tomorrow, what will your users do? Are they going to be stuck? Are they going to irrevocably lose data? Or, like with the three flashlights, will they be able to look at that and say, well, that one's broken, but I can grab this one and I can keep on going? Or in the case of cave diving, if lights die, you turn around and you go out, but you get the idea. And there are those two kind of sides. There are the things that you can discard and replace, and there are the things that you can fix on the fly. But all of this is predicated on the notion that you can answer truthfully that your users would be able to recover, they would be able to go forward if your project went away. We need to consider this when we're building network services, when we're building free software, when we're trying to build the foundation, realize the vision, and realize the potential of the internet. So in review, authentication is an important problem. It's an open problem. Persona failed. Please learn from what we failed on. Please try to fix this. I have a side project that several developers and myself are working on called Portier that tries to be a much more constrained version of Persona that just focuses on the email authentication. We learned that free licenses don't guarantee functional freedom. Nobody was able to take Persona and stand it up outside of Mozilla without also throwing away all of the network, all of the established value that we had created. Define your scope and solve a specific problem. Consciously consider your project's death. Try to minimize the harm that comes to your users with the death of your project. And please, please, please talk about failures. Talk about the projects that didn't work out. We need to learn from each other. Write this up, blog about it, tweet about it. We can't keep repeating the same mistakes. That's all I've got. I want to thank you. I want to thank LCA again. This has been great. I think we have time for questions if people have questions. I don't know. Where's Chris?
Dan, hi. Yeah. So we have 1 minute. We have 1 minute, which means we can take one question, but you've got to be certain it's really, really, really good. What a surprise.
Fantastic talk. Thanks very much. You mentioned Lanyard, and I have a little bit of a similar experience. When it's a commercial project, there are reasons to not be public as well, because as soon as you say it might be going away, oh no, the company's going to fail. So how much of that do you moderate that influence of we don't want the entire company to fail versus we need to tell people?
So the nice thing about the free software world is we can just ignore that facet. So what's more is every project's going to be unique. If the viability of your company, if your paycheck, if the way that you feed your family is dependent on people believing that this dead project is still alive, it's probably time to start planning for alternatives. It's not a winning strategy. But it's also, you have to consider the harm you're doing to the ecosystem and not allowing other people to stand up and take your place and provide a valuable service. So I think that's it. I'm around all week. If you're interested in what Mozilla is doing, again, please reach out to me. We work in the open. You can volunteer. You can contribute. Thank you so much.
So, hi, Dan. As a token of our appreciation, we have a bottle of Tasmanian rye whiskey from the Belgrove Distillery. There's a wonderful story behind that I won't bore the audience with at some point, but I'm sure I can explain it to you at some other point. And a Tasmanian devil figurine type thing. Everybody, please thank Dan so Callahan for such a fantastic insightful keynote. So.